the News Channel 5 network, this is Open Line.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Open Line. We have a great panel tonight talking about a very important issue, talking about juvenile crime here in Nashville and across the state in our broken juvenile justice system. You may have seen some of the reports that we've been doing. We are committed to discussing this issue. We've done investigative reports on almost every newscast. Happy to talk about it further with a great panel tonight. We have with us Lonnell Matthews, Davidson County Juvenile Court Clerk. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me, Ben.
We have Ashford Hughes, the former Chief Diversity and Equity and Inclusion Officer here in Metro. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And we also have Shane Foster with Amend Together. That's a program of the YWCA. We'll have you explain that in a moment, but thank you for being here as well.
Thanks for having me.
I want to start. We've been talking about this here on Channel 5 with a series of reports. We've called it broken. I want to ask from each of your perspectives. Number one, when we're talking about the juvenile justice system, is that an appropriate title? And kind of what is your experience at this point with juvenile justice right now? What are you seeing? But I'll start with you.
Ben, I applaud Channel 5 for covering this topic. I think we tend to, as a community, come back to the topic after a series of incidents happen in the community or a large incident happens. But bringing the attention to the topic and bringing multiple perspectives, I think, is helpful. In terms of broken, one of my mentors, Howard Gentry, actually, we were talking about the judicial system before I ran for the position I currently hold as juvenile court clerk. And he explained it to me. He said, you know, the system's not really broken. The system was designed in a way to produce some of the results that we see today. And in essence, we have to look at how we could break it. Not saying that it's mistitled your series, but I do think that to some degree, there are some systems that were designed to have a marginalized effect on certain communities.
So we could do better. What we're seeing is not the desirable outcome.
Yes.
And that you're saying is systematic.
I think it's systematic. I think that there are several factors that need to be examined, need to be improved. I think that we could do a lot as a community to create better outcomes for young people and their families.
And Ashford Hughes, as the former Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer, what have you seen as far as our community and juvenile crime, and kind of what do you think needs to be highlighted?
Well, I personally think it goes beyond just calling it a juvenile crime issue, or is the juvenile justice system broken. We're talking about environments, socioeconomic infrastructure that has led to some of the outcomes that we're seeing right now today. If you go into a lot of these communities where we see a lot of these issues happening, look at what's taking place right now. You have concentrated poverty that has been there for years. You have communities that feel as though they're not represented well within our city. We don't have a lot of economic development, right? We see education. We have issues of education in some of these communities. This is a structure, a system, as Lonnell said, that we need to really deconstruct and to really ask ourselves different questions as we're looking at this issue. Are we seeing it from the right lens? Are we really understanding really what's taking place beyond a juvenile court system? Let's look at the holistic approach to the way that we utilize and look at communities moving forward.
You said in one of the stories that you did with Phil Williams, there was discussion about declaring a public health emergency.
Yep.
Is that right?
A public health crisis.
A public health crisis.
Yep.
So talk about that.
So I believe wholeheartedly, and this is what one of my mentors taught me as well, Mayor Megan Berry, she always stated, what gets measured gets done, right? So when I even look at something that's parallel to this issue, but just as important, is the opioid crisis. Before we declared opioids a crisis, we had these pockets of things taking place in the community. Once we declared there was an opioid crisis, we began to really, as communities, not just in Nashville, not just in Tennessee, but across the country, organize around efforts to alleviate that problem. This is the same type of magnitude as the opioid crisis. This also, you know, this crime that we see, this hopelessness sometimes that we see in these communities isn't just happening within this last decade. We've seen this over the last 2 and 3 decades based off of public policy, based off of lack of communities being economically advantaged as others. So this is something that when we declare a public crisis, it begins to make certain that those communities know we're taking them seriously, we care about their outcomes, and we expressly want them to participate in the economic advances that are going on within our city.
And of course, the next question then becomes, what do we do? Part of it's talking about it, but what do we do? And before I get into that, I want to go to you, Shane. Amend Together, a program of the YWCA. What is that, and kind of how does that put you in a position to talk about, you know, our juvenile justice system?
Well, Amend Together is a primary prevention initiative that's dedicated to ending violence against women and girls, particularly by engaging men and boys to ultimately change this culture that supports violence. As we talk about culture, we're talking about many of the issues that have been prevalent in our society for a very long time in terms of how we interact with each other, how we talk to each other, how we interact with women and girls. Many of the things that we've prescribed to as it relates to how we define manhood and masculinity. What we are able to see through a lot of our work with young people, as we work with more than 600 boys here in Nashville, is a concerted effort to really defend their manhood and their masculinity at every turn, and not even just our youth. We're talking about adult men even having that feeling of having to defend that on a day-to-day basis in so many different ways. And when you define manhood by being tough, by being strong, not showing any weakness, these are kind of things that really show up as it relates to youth violence, as it relates to violence in general, particularly as we talk about a lot violence against women and girls. When you think about what's happening in just our city of Nashville, where one out of every four women are experiencing domestic violence, we're fifth in the nation for men killing women. This is the example that our young people are seeing in our adults. All right, well, one out of every five women being sexually assaulted. These are not people who are strangers of sorts. These are folks that we know that are committing these types of crimes. And there has to be a concerted effort amongst the community from everyone to not only hold people accountable, but to really be preventative, to talk about these issues, but to put tools and resources and education out in front of people before the violence happens. So we talk a lot about really engaging men, not indicting folks, but really inviting men and boys to be role models, to be a catalyst for change, to teach other men and boys how to value and respect women and girls, and ultimately how to value and respect each other.
And I've heard that discussed on a national level. Is Nashville worse? Is it worse here in Nashville than on a national level? And I'll ask each of you that, but I'll start with you for what you're talking about.
I don't know if it's worse than other communities, but it's pretty significant here. What I've seen since I've been back in Nashville, since I retired from playing ball in 2013, you know, is that Nashville is a community where, unfortunately, so much of what's happening gets swept under the rug. We've subscribed to this mentality that what happens in our house stays in our house, or we sweep things under the rug and don't really talk about what's happening as much as we should. And just being transparent, when we talk about these issues of violence against women and girls, it's literally the most underreported crimes in the world. So even the statistic that we have don't necessarily represent all that's actually happening. And too often we're going into communities where people are so adept at saying, well, you know, we had nice people here, we had good families here, we don't have that problem here. Where the reality is, if the statistics bear it out, every single one of us, whether we want to believe it or not, are connected to a woman or girl who is a victim of this kind of violence. And when you start talking about our young people, what's happening with youth violence as it relates to this issue of violence against women, you're talking about one out of every six girls having experienced sexual violence, one out of every seven boys having experienced sexual violence. You're talking about a significant part of our young people that have experienced this kind of violence. And what are we doing for that? You know, and the question becomes, how do we hold ourselves as adults accountable for our actions and our deeds and our behaviors? Because ultimately, they're following our lead. And so that's what I would say to that.
And I know other communities are dealing with juvenile crime. What are some of the unique things here in Nashville? And do you think, and I'll ask both of you this, I'll start with you, Ed, do you think we're worse off than other places?
The numbers tell us that we're not worse off than other places. When we look at juvenile crime, I think the numbers are down. Now, the ages of the people that are getting involved have gotten younger over the period of time. But as I travel and work with some of our other peer cities, they're experiencing the same type of trauma at the same type of pace as we are. The problem that we have here is because Nashville is really spawning and growing out, particularly over the last 10 years, people are now really starting to see it as that growth has spread out to Madison, to the southeast Davidson County, to Bordeaux and those other areas. It is now that we've been the it city, people are starting to pay more attention to these things. And unfortunately, Nashville has had two young black men murdered, killed at the hands of police officers, which has also heightened that kind of understanding from the community about what's going on. And as we see the growth, and what has also has allowed this, as we see the growth of communities in this city, we also see that black communities in particular and brown communities are not growing or not prospering at the same rate. So again, I go back to that concentrated poverty, that outlook on life that people feel kind of hopeless, that the community, there's no hope for them, right? So then that is where we have to work with our city partners to really say, this is an issue, how do we address this issue? And one of the quick ways is that we take a look in a look at ourselves and say, how can we provide more access to opportunity, both financially, both socially, both education-wise, to these communities so they feel as though they are a part of Nashville and part of the prosperity moving forward?
So you can't have an honest discussion about this. You cannot, unless we talk about race. Is that a fair statement?
That's fair.
And so how do we broach that in relation to juvenile crime in Nashville? What do you think we need to be focused on talking about?
I think we need to be open-minded to the history of race in Nashville. I think some reconciliation work needs to be done in terms of race relations in our city. But we also need to be honest about the disparities and the marginalization of black and brown people in our communities. When it comes to education, when it comes to employment, when it comes to health, when it comes to incarceration, black and brown people are disproportionately affected. And until it directly impacts the majority community, they probably don't pay attention to the issue. And once you get people to pay attention, like Ashford said, Nashville has an abundance of resources. We have nonprofits that are very generous and giving and want to give back to this community. We have a pretty good philanthropic community that supports those nonprofits. We need to do better at collaborating amongst nonprofits, government, and inner sectors, including business in that. We need to do better at measuring ourselves and reassessing what works, what doesn't work, and building capacity and scaling some of the things that are working well.
And how do you think, I mean, we're all talking about this up here. That's interesting what you're saying, how we solve it. I want to ask each of you, how do we go beyond talking and actually make a difference and make some inroads and solve some of this? And I'll ask you and then you, Shane.
Well, I think it starts with actually the leadership in the city convening, right? First convening the business leaders, nonprofit, convening those folks at the table and outline with the data, letting the data really tell us the story of where we need to move forward, and incorporating community and these grassroots voices and solutions. We haven't really done a good job as a city of including those voices in the solution-based process. Once we have city leaders to convene that table, then we begin to address what can we begin to take on one bite at a time. This is not a hocus pocus, we can come with a magic wand and fix it, but we definitely have the resources, the manpower to be able to help these grassroots community organizations scale up to do more of the work that they're doing, to work with these kids, to work with these parents, to work with the school system, to work within metro government to pass quality policy. But first, if we don't convene people at the table first, declare it to be what it is, which is a health crisis, then we will continue to just walk around, and we cannot do one-offs. We cannot say we're going to give this organization this amount of money this year, and then next year that organization isn't thought of. We have to be consistent over a period of time and address this as such.
And what do you think? How do we move beyond the talk and actually make a difference?
Well, one of the things that has been interesting to me in Nashville is we talk a lot about diversity and inclusion, but I've been very fortunate because I played ball at Vandy and have a lot of fans here in Nashville, and many of them follow me on social media. And diversity and inclusion is not what I see. We talk about it. We talk about it in our businesses, but our businesses don't reflect diversity and inclusion. So the example that we're setting for our kids and for this youth is that we're hypocrites. We're ones that want to talk about it, but we don't actually want to do it, right? So for me, it starts at a grassroots level and really being able to say, how can we break bread together? My late mentor and friend, David Williams, he would always say that I can't always do what I want to do, but I can always do what I can do. And what we can do is start to build relationships, start to build friendships. How many of us are reaching back to people who are in poverty situations and having dinner at their house? How many of us are going and spending time with youth that, you know, look different than us, who have different experiences? What it does is it allows us to understand exactly what's going on, where we're not the adult saying, well, this is what they need over here. No, I know what they need because I've listened to them. I've talked to them, right? And that comes from, like Lonnell was saying, really being able to collaborate more and being able to talk really about the issues and really getting our solutions from the people that are being marginalized the most.
Fascinating. All right, we have to take a break. We have several calls here on the line. Hold on the line, and there are a few lines that are open. If you want to call in, there's the number 615-737-PLUS, 615-737-7587. Take a break, continue our discussion. Be back right after this.